When we talk about the doctrine of Christology, that division of theology that focuses on the second person of the Trinity, Jesus, we understand that he is fully God, that he is divine, he's deity, but he's also fully human. He is a man. He became like us. He was born one of us. So though he was always God, he became man. In other words, his deity is eternal. And no matter what direction of time you go, past or future, he's God. But he entered time in the incarnation. He became a man. Now, at this time of year, when I'm recording this, we're about to celebrate Christmas. And so we think specifically of the incarnation. And that simply means that Jesus became incarnate. He took on flesh and became a man. Now, he was not always a man. He became a man. But once he became a man, he stays a man. He's fully God and fully man. What does the Bible say about Jesus' humanity? Well, first of all, we know that he is born of a virgin. This was the testimony in Matthew chapter 1, verse 18. Matthew writes these words. Now, the birth of Jesus Christ took place in this way. When the mother Mary had been betrothed to Joseph, before they came together, she was found to be with child from the Holy Spirit. And her husband Joseph, being a just man and unwilling to put her to shame, resolved to divorce her quietly. But as he considered these things, behold, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream, saying, Joseph, son of David, do not fear to take Mary as your wife, for that which is conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. Now, twice in that those few verses, Matthew expresses that Jesus is not the product of normal human conception. Joseph is not his earthly father. Mary is conceived this child of the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit has implanted, has in essence fertilized her egg. He's not the product of a fallen human father and a sinful human mother. He's the product of the Holy Spirit who fertilizes the egg of Jesus' mother Mary. And I believe this teaches us that the sin nature is passed down through the father. Mary is not, as our Catholic friends say, immaculately conceived herself. She had a sin nature. But Jesus does not, because he's conceived of the Holy Spirit. Listen to Mary's testimony in Luke chapter 1, verse 34. Mary said to the angel, when the angel says, you're going to conceive a child, bear a son, she says, how can this be, since I am the Greek word is parthenos, a virgin. Now, there are those who say, well, that doesn't really mean virgin. Well, if you go to Greece, to Athens, and you go up on the Acropolis in Athens, there's a big temple there, and it's called the Parthenon. And the Parthenon is dedicated to the goddess Athena, who is the virgin goddess. That very temple is dedicated to her virginity. So I say that just to explain to you that the word Parthenos means virgin. That's the word Mary uses. It's the word Matthew uses to describe her. She says, how can I conceive since I'm a virgin? And the angel assured her, the Holy Spirit will come upon you and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. Therefore, the child to be born will be called Holy, the Son of God, not the son of Joseph, the Son of God. So Jesus is virgin born. Some people say, well, it doesn't really matter if he's virgin born or not. It absolutely matters. If Jesus is not born of a virgin, then he has the same sinful nature that I do. He's a son of Adam in the same way that I am, which means he inherited this sinful disposition. He was conceived and born in sin, but he wasn't. He was conceived of the Holy Spirit. And that's why from his birth, he's called Holy, the Son of God. So Jesus is conceived of the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, but he is fully human. He has human characteristics. He has a human body. When Mary gives birth to him, what does she do? She takes her firstborn and wraps him in swaddling cloths and reclines him, lays him in a manger because there was no place for them in the inn. In other words, he's a baby like any other baby. She has to swaddle him. She has to comfort him. She has to diaper him. She has to nurse him and care for him. Because he's in a human body, he is humanly totally helpless, but his body is real. In Luke 2:40, we're told that as a child, Jesus grew and became strong, filled with wisdom, and the favor of God was upon him. We see that he gets thirsty. In John chapter 3, he goes to Jacob's well and he wants a drink. He gets hungry in Matthew 4:2, after fasting 40 days, he's hungry and he has to be fed. We know that he has a human mind, just like your mind and my mind. Even though he has this completely divine nature, he limits himself in his infancy and childhood, certainly, because we're told that in Luke 2:52, that Jesus increased in wisdom and in stature and in favor with God and man. In other words, he chooses to live as a human being. He doesn't think of it like he doesn't access the vast bank of knowledge that is available to him, though it is available to him, and it's his knowledge. He limits himself in this human form to grow, to learn, to experience the very things that all his brothers and sisters know and experience. He has a human soul. John 12:27, Jesus prayed, "Now is my soul troubled. And what shall I say? Father, save me from this hour. For this very purpose I came into the world." John 13:21, after saying these things, Jesus was troubled in his spirit and said, "One of you is going to betray me." In Matthew 26:38, then he said to them, "My soul is very sorrowful, even to death. Remain here and watch with me." So Jesus referred to his own soul. You know, he also had human emotions. In Matthew 8:10, it says that he marveled at this. And John 11:35, at the graveside of Lazarus, Jesus wept. Hebrews chapter 5, verses 7 and 8, we're told that in the days of his flesh, he offered up prayers and supplications with loud cries and tears. Now, you know, you don't really see that pictured that much in the Gospels, but the writer to the Hebrews is writing in the very generation in which Jesus had lived, and no doubt knew people that had known Jesus and had been around Jesus and heard him pray. And he reports that Jesus prayed with loud cries and tears. He's a faithful high priest who's touched with the feelings of our infirmities. So because he's fully human, because he's in a body, he experienced pain, he suffered grief, he had real emotions, he's able to identify with us. At this time of year when we celebrate Christmas, it's important for us to remember why it's so significant that Jesus became a man and became one of us. And because he's one of us, he can save us. He lived a sinless life so that he could pay for our sin on Calvary's cross. He had to be a real man in a real body, but he had to be free from sin in order to accomplish that. What a glorious truth.